Chapter 10. The Promise of God. Remember the faith, and this is eternal life, that they might know thee, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Being justified by faith, we have peace with God, through our Lord Jesus Christ. When the harp shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. The peace of God surpasseth all understanding. They've obtained like precious faith with us. That I might know him, and the power of his resurrection, declared before the foundation of the world. That in him might dwell the fullness of all things. What we don't see, our youth are not prepared for the war that is around the corner, and their parents are oblivious. Faith is a universal value that all beings have, because all beings have been left stranded in reality without a sustained and living presence of absolute truth, and every single creature of intelligent sentience refers to faith, hope, trust, and emotional judgment to counterbalance this absence. In this, there is a steady divide, a concurring, growing fracture, that takes more and more with it, with each passing generation, as it stretches out across every batch of young person, mind, and heart. Our faith is not maintained by anything we ourselves believe. It is not set upon anything we feel by heart or mind. It is entirely rested upon the singular principle of Christ, being who he says he is, and with his name is all the Godhead bodily presented. We are the enemy of the world, and Christians, with emotional sentiment and worldly passions, are eager to not see this fact, to casually omit it from their logic and their reason, and sweep it swiftly under the rug. Christ is the Lord, the King, future master of everything that is, and even now, is the present tense owner of all creation. There is no religion or faith in the world that makes this claim, except that soul whom confesses that Jesus is the Christ, the eternal light of God, born in the flesh, who arose in victory over the law, and who sits at the right hand of God the eternal Father, waiting for the day that his Father will send him to claim what is his. No one will accept this. None, not that Christ is King, not except they honestly believe it. And every Christian who knows this faith is unable to bow to anything that the world will ask of us concerning its sin. That is, we cannot omit sin. We fall, we fumble, but we are every last one called toward perfection, and commanded to respect the throne of Jesus Christ, as servants, who go before an all-powerful, absolute God. We fear Christ. We fear his authority. We fear his judgment. We fear his wrath. And even if we wanted to, we cannot part the waters of sin and tell spiritual Egypt to follow the Christ of God, when spiritual Egypt hates God with an absolute resolution to kill his children, and pursues us in haste and bitter contempt to taunt, aggravate, and exile us from this plane of existence. The world is pushing more and more toward its complete transformation into that great Sodom. It is devouring the hearts of the youth in its homosexual philosophy with such aggressive speeds that it will soon convince all to make a choice, and such deliberation has even entered the walls of the church. Soon, the Holy Spirit will shake off its feet. It will draw all its children to itself, and everything that hates the Holy Spirit will join itself to the world, and the church will have its greatest contest to date, its most powerful schism. Hearts will tear, souls will bend and bleed in Christ, as friends become impassioned enemies, and Christians, faithful to the living God, who acknowledge the throne of Jesus Christ, become the targeted enemies of the world, accused of hate, of hypocrisy, of violating civil liberties, by offense to human freedoms. Sympathy will conquer many, and this, before the world begins its purge of Christians, the Spirit cannot deny Christ. Not prepared, that is the recurrent theme of everything we hear in the Spirit, that the world has so fully immersed itself into the Christian culture, that such rare exception exists to this statement, that we are all, every last one, except those very precious few, not ready, not prepared. We cannot see, we cannot hear, we cannot sense, we cannot feel. We have no regard for holiness, no sensitivity to righteousness, no understanding for the goodness of God, not a sliver of knowledge toward the promise of God. When the day comes that everything Christ is illegal, and every single seminary and church in the free world are condemned by lethal and legal action, where shall the faith appear? Where will those souls who trusted in all their religious confidence find truth, life, and sustain meaning? As the ten virgins, the soul is not prepared to face the confidence of Christ, to gather itself to the exceeding glory of the Son of God, because in his divine absence, the Church forgot its sacredness, its holy membership in the family of God, and turned all spiritual truth into the fruits of the world. It became religious, as commonplace as prostitution. We've not been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. We've been taken in by the spirit of showmanship and arm-flapping productions. We've graciously joined our conscience to ideas and philosophies and nice-sounding things, but we have not in the least seen the throne of God, not in the slightest revered the Son of God, not in the faintest come close to that commonwealth of faith, the Father's call, the Lord Jesus Christ. This is not the world that has the Church of Jesus Christ on it. This is the world that has the Church of Satan, pretending to be the Church of Jesus Christ, because the faith was replaced by faith in the world, and the spirit of holiness by the spirit of the world, and the body of Christ was replaced by the self-serving, apathetic, lazy, and estranged individuals, who have no sense of Christ, the Holy Family, the sacred kingdom to come, or the eternal aims, to everlast, under the rulership of Jesus Christ. No one is prepared. The world can counsel itself any which way it wants, but it is living out its feeble lives, in fruitless bravado and certain vanity, while sailing upon its dreams, on the seas of doomed time. This world, every sentiment on it, every brave rebellion against the design of God, every passionate fight against Jesus Christ, every army, every leader, every broken and unholy angel on it, around it, in it, upon it, is entirely one wrapped and packaged end. It is finished already. It just waits for that day. No one is prepared, least of all the Church, who should be first among all the earth to stand ready, even herald his day. But none are prepared, not in heart, not in soul, not in mind, not in essence, not for the things to come, not for the things to happen, and certainly not for the glory of God, or the day after. Christ is King. Earth is His. Reality is His. Forever is His. Judgment is His. And all within all are His. No one can change this. No one can take His victory from Him. No one can stop the day to come. Yet, all dance in carnal merriment of forgetfulness and fruitless rebellion, giving no thought to the end of all things, at the certainty of His spoken word. And why? Because we're selfishly set to worship our own selves, and think of nothing but self. We'll all die, and He'll still be upon the eternal throne, that no mortal man may approach or sit upon. Our children will all die, and He will still sit upon the eternal throne of eternal life. Our children's children will all die, and they will, every last one, stand with us before the eternal throne of everlasting judgment, that no mortal may approach or sit upon. We die, yet Jesus Christ is eternal. He is the everlasting glory of God. No one considers this. No one debates their argument against forgetting His name. No one prepares their heart for the hour of His revelation. No one is ready to face the image of the eternal God and live, least of all those on the earth who are called by His name. See it. The age before the return of the Christ sings a song of freedom from righteousness. It calls itself liberated from God. It revels in its mind and its gross affection. There is no place for a holy and Christ-consecrated Church in the last hours of the human race, and neither the world nor the Church can see this, because neither can see that the human race is separate from the Church, and thrives on a separate and different lifetime. The human race must finish its course. It must decide itself for hell or God, as every mortal before them. But they will have the burning confessions of the saints they killed, clutching their souls in tight contest as they sleep, as they find themselves haunted by the memory of the servants of Jesus Christ, who gave their testimony of allegiance to the eternal King. At the hour of their parting ways with the world, the Holy Spirit convicts every saint, and brings every one of them into alignment with the Spirit of Christ. And this, for many of us, is like a haunting dread, one that we have all had to acclimate to, and learn to appreciate, because it is the working spirit of salvation. What awaits the world as like an echoing rift of conscious percussion. Haunting sounds they cannot escape. Pain, they cannot ignore. Their conscience, if they have one at all, on fire with shame and relentless conviction. Because the voice of the saints is the sound of Christ's impending kingdom. Equations, never written by hand of man, will be seen in the eye of the soul, and the eternal promise will be spelled out upon the soul like an image written in crystal. No child, woman, or ghostly man shall avoid the call of God upon his being to make a definitive connection to his decision concerning the living throne of God and Jesus Christ. And it will not be man who preaches this gospel, but the Spirit himself, the most undeniable force in all of existence, who sees heart and soul and will of man, will compress every understanding into compact resolution, so that nothing will escape this moment of knowledge. Knowing evil, as evil is, as it is to God, seeing in the Spirit, the throne of Jesus Christ, who the living God, has proclaimed, they will all be taught of God. And I in the last days, I will pour out my Spirit. The apostles all knew and understood, despite any furtherance of time or generations of man, that from the ascension of Christ, the Master, all existence was propelled into irrevocable status as being the last times. All efforts, fights, struggles, and works of any nature, are then on the present tense citizens of the last days, and all mystery of the Father, His Holy Spirit, and the Master Jesus Christ, preside over these days, and the souls in them, with such an eye of declaration, that these are the last times, according to their own proclamation and promise. We must pray for the church. The church is in danger, because we are all asleep, all lazy, all lulled over by the magic of the world, captivated by its mysteries and its thrills, that not one mean anything before the throne of God. But here on earth, they stammer our being like a love-struck teenager. We don't know how close we are to the end. We don't know a single date. We don't know a single hour. We don't know the end from tomorrow, or today, from the end. And yet we carry on like careless school children, whose only concern is bullies, the reputation they think they have, and how indecent and messed up their parents are. The modernized church, as a spirit, has lost its smallest similarity to the church the fathers founded. They don't care about anything, except reputations, money, and the numbers they see on paper. Faithfulness to the throne of Jesus Christ is gone. Even his name is merely a figurehead for their profiting, a safety word for their false faith. As even the preachers and priests have long struggled to remember a holy and eternal kingdom, seeing the stars above, and not remembering how they will every single one be taken down by Jesus Christ, and his kingdom, replace everything that is, forever, from the family of God to the family at home, we need prayer, desperately, and faithfully. With sincere hearts and earnest expectations, we need to remember the righteousness of our eternal King. We need to remember the width and depth and length of His kingdom. We need to remember the difference between all that is temporary, and all that is sworn by promise of God, to stand eternally. We must pray for soul, for spirit, for family, for church, for truth, for life, for worthiness, and for faithfulness in all our members. As we are all members of the great body of Jesus Christ, where are the shepherds? Look out across the landscape of time. See the church through every generation, and you will see the staggering sway of allegiance to Satan. Everywhere that the good Lord's name is presented, darkness, and dark conspiracies of heart and soul, and minds tainted and twisted with fetish and secret sins and vice beyond any simple man's description, destroy the sacred trust of our relationship. The shepherds are not. Angels of hell are everywhere, plotting for the throne of God, that none may have, but all of them know is beyond their grasp. Fear, in the conscience molds so many of them. Fear, that must preach in order to prove their imagined and presumed salvation. But these have no awareness of Christ. They serve themselves. They praise their fear. They speak, to speak, not by love, by commandment of show. They pretend for man. They pretend for others, even to persuade their family of their call. But these are not able to persuade the Holy Spirit, any more than they know the Spirit of the Holy One of God. Then too, you will see the youth, who once looked at Christ with such vigor and determination, But by the steady counsel of corrupt elders and fallen church parents, they lost their way, little by little, moving away from Jesus, and moving toward the valley of decision. These were taught and trained and their faith manipulated by those who were spiritually accosted and molested like them. And just as it happens across the psychology of the child abused, so it happens across the ages of the psychology of faithfulness. Men, women, and children, no matter their first love for Christ, by the devil's character and patience and goading, can be torqued and moved and bent and destroyed. Faith of their heart, moved to the confidence of man's instruction, from the Holy Spirit, to the perpetual sins of blasphemous heresies and Satan's carefully instituted entanglements of corrupt perpetuation. The enemy has well damaged the spirit of man's faith, and none can see past the schisms of his crafting work. Where is the Institute? Where is the Spirit? Where is the common faith? Where is the singular body of Christ? None can tell. The work of the devil was done so well, sloppy, to say the least, but clever enough for the frail paranoia of mortals to contend with nothing except each other. No one takes on the spirit of Antichrist. No one stands true against Satan's perpetuation. No one guards the church against heresy. All the rather, all the contrary, they do not guard. They do not stand. They do not contend. They anoint it. They crown it. They delight in it. They set it up in the chiefest of esteems. They regard it as king. They make it church law. They give it a seat at every feast. They install it, as the world would install constitutions or amendments. The shepherds have vanished. The church is on its own. Spirits are the enemy. Spirits are the powers in control. Spirits move heart and soul of all that are not consecrated to the mastery of the sovereign Lord and God, Jesus Christ, Master, over all the house of God's estate. Where are the shepherds, the souls, who are bound soul to spirit, in holy and sacred trust, to the will of God, to the commission of the kingdom of Jesus Christ, to the mission, to bring Rachel to her husband, true, and unharmed, to the spirit of love, and the wisdom of it, so that no tenderness of affection may be convinced against the wise counsel of righteous distinction, that are true in Christ, the world versus the church. It is not fair, it is not nice, it is not soft and precious, it is sharp, and painful, and reality ending. The word of God has destroyed all possibility of our mutual estate. He has cut us soul and member, severed our tied binds, loosed our rote collars, that bound every man like pieces and parts on an assembly line, where once the masters of earth could look down upon man and see the rows and lines of their worked bondage, their enslaved property, just as Jesus, who had his disciples to sit in numbered rows, the world, and the church. How horrible is the fall of the church, that neither a man in the church, or a woman in the world, can tell the difference. We speak the same, we act the same, we do the same things, enjoy the same sins, rally ourselves to the same secret leisure and pleasures. We eat, drink, and party the same. Even the inescapable name of the sovereign Lord, Jesus Christ, is spoken as any commonplace curse, by both their parents and their children. There is no clear distinction between the church and the world, except to say, the world sins openly, doesn't hide it, and the world is true in everything it does. It lies true, it sins true, it worships satanic influences with all the truthfulness of its heart and spirit. But the church, for pretense, makes a show of its long-forsaken holiness, declaring it's kept virtue like a lying daughter. It is long past its age of deflower. It has slept and whored outside the marriage. It has had its sacredness given to every foul spirit that passed by and hissed. The church is a sacred body. It is the housed collective of all the saints of earth, who share the singular confession of faith, and trust heart and soul, that Jesus Christ is the Son eternal, of the holy and eternal God. It is sealed, like a purchased possession, and awaits the day of its redemption, the day that its owner will come forward, and with his proving spirit, match the spirit that is sealed in them who wait, prepared for him. This sacred church is cut from the cord of the world. It is not bound to the world's spiritual influence. It is not reconciled according to the world's wisdom. Yet, we are each called out from within the world, and each, as those before us, and those with us, patiently and bravely, await the Sovereign Lord, our destined redemption. The Church is but a footnote, a flower, beside the roadside of the eternal age to follow. No one, mortal or spirit, has ever seen the eternal, has ever known the eternal, except Jesus Christ. But in the age to come, the eternal shall involve all in his own spirit, and all shall share in his everlasting spirit, and be eternal with him. And this, the Church has the promise of. The faith, the world has no such promise. No eternal spirit, no eternal God, no eternal truth. It has now, it has the grave, it has the counsel of its own wisdom, it has the fullness of every mischief it can find and delight in, to carry it forward to the day of its miserable conclusion, where, in misery and regret, and deep longing, it will approach the blackness of death, and realize how sovereign the Eternal is, and it will want, beside itself, and beside all it can ever do again, for that Christ, that it mocked, ridiculed, and hated, because it will see the everlasting sovereignty of righteousness. We see the kingdom of the everlasting, we see the everlasting, who rules that kingdom. We see mysteries, clothed in everlasting truth and fullness, that we have no words for. We see the end, from the beginning, we see the eternity that awaits, we sense the power and the truth of the Righteous One of God, and we share this whose right it is Lord, with all we can, resisting Satan. What is apostasy? If it were permitted by the Holy Spirit, every office in the Church would be listed here, but such is akin to war, and that is not the case of this mention. The world is apostasy. It is the spirit of the world, the spirit of Egypt, that binding illusion of a state, and false membership, of being consciously bound to its citizenship, even as the dog to its master. Apostasy is that spirit. It is the murmuring and complaining of the disciples of Jesus Christ, who yearn to return to the world, to heaven, to hold and to pleasure in all the things delightful to the eye, just as the mother of the world, whose eye fell upon the wares of the serpent, Jesus, appointed the apostles. The apostles labored, built the Church on word and spirit, bled and died for the sacred truths of Christ, but with every single earthly conscience entered into the common affair of the Church, came that serpent spirit with them. And so instinctual is its slithering on the earth, that man cannot escape it without the express possession of the Holy Spirit. Every Church that wanted the world became apostate. It left the faith. It surrendered its faithfulness to Jesus Christ. It gave up the holy fight. And even now, the Mother Church is institutionally slithering more and more toward such great apostasy, as it seeks to join itself to the spirit of the world, and to ordain the spirit of the world, who is Satan, over its own seat, manifesting, by conscious alignment and worship in spirit, the sudden mesmerizing appearance of their incarnate angel of hell, into this reality. Apostasy, no matter how you word it, is the sacred law of spiritual faithfulness, being betrayed by an unfaithful soul, with an unfaithful spirit. Apostasy, no matter how you examine it, is that spirit of Antichrist, that has claimed us all, in some measure or another, because our parents sold us to Satan, just as theirs did, and theirs before them, as centuries past, they have done, as the age before this one did, and the age before that one. Man, in all his carnations, always turns away from the living God, and gives child and nation to the dragon of old, that great and treacherous spirit of antagonistic intensities, that is unmatched in wise deceptions and coy manipulations. Women, who are so aptly named his apostles, are natural slithering sirens of both wordplay and temptation, and yet, by comparison, they are as dumb and taken in by the snake, as any simple man, fallen before their alluring dance. Apostasy is that snake that is in our mind, our heart, our words, our lives, that separates us from the Holy Spirit of God, and it commissions us like apostles and disciples, to go forth into all the Church, and teach them in the name of the world and the snake, and the enchanting dragon of old. We are the apostasy. It is something we become, a spirit that we carry forth in perpetuation and continuous motion, that transforms word and deed into the shaped instruments of dark counsel and false salvation. Apostasy is the spirit of Antichrist, and it works in all of us, because we were adopted by it, trained by it, taught in its mindfulness, and its ways. We see through its eyes, hear scripture and sermon, through its clever filters, are molded by its wisdom, because we want, and we want, and we want, but never the Holy Spirit, never the absolute sovereignty of Jesus Christ. We do not ever want Christ, never, because He is unshakable, fixed upon holiness. We want the world, invisible realities versus the Word of God. Man is unaware of the distinctions, unaware of the conscious borders, unaware of his enemies, his true enemies, and his absolute enemies, and not aware of how to tell the difference between anything. Everything that surrounds us is lie, because it exists in a conditional state. It is not absolute. From the things we see, to the nations that man suggests exist by his imagined and agreed upon commitments, it is all subjective, all according to opinion or condition. Nothing that is, not in actuality, but in the argument of its case. Each and every strand of existence is numerically assigned. Each and every soul is consciously associated to everything it believes, that it believes in. Every border is temporal, whether the physical border of density, or the allegiance of thought that elects a man into office, is a mother by practical demographic of the relationship, or by maternal affections of the relationship, is a brother someone who is linked by numeric sequence of genes, or by the bonds of fellowship, suffering, and heartache is shared, is a nation set in principle, or by the word of a dictator who says this thing is so, because they said it is a dictator, the power to dictate, or the delusional state of a man who is let loose upon the world with a child's imaginative sovereignty and equally childish rage of tantrums for not getting their immediate way, who no one put in their place. Where are the lines? All in the mind, a single rose, or the entire garden, a child in the womb, or a princess waiting for her kingdom, a job, or a career, a way of life, or the way we see it. We live, and we die, and everything we experience is gauged by values we believe in, by invisible rules, an invisible rulership, by unseen lines, that we believe are apparent. We don't see mothers, or teachers, or leaders. These are titles we assign. We don't see nations, or kings, or borders. We assume they are, according to someone's word. We take everything for granted, every monetary unit, every smile, every passing day. It is all the illusion of values we trust to be real, by merit of, hoped upon, associations. We hope the smile is genuine affection. We hope the money we have is worth what we think it is, to whoever we intend to give it to. We hope the sun will finish its setting, without some major end to all existence. We hope that everything we think, and everything we believe, is matched by some form of practical, tangible, and realized value. Ironic. This is exactly the insanity that Christians are accused of, for hoping upon the legitimacy of the claims of Jesus Christ, for believing his blood of fact to be divine, that he is who God swore before existence would come forth from the highest and put every power, law, and angel in existence beneath his feet. We believe upon the name of Jesus Christ that he is the sovereign king, and we expect his kingdom and the fullness of all his works. The last times, there is only one tick on the clock left, regarding the state of man as is, the final days before the millennial age, and then, it is a different season, with a different mind, and a different conscious perception, the millennial age. In it, saint, angel, and man alike will arrive beneath the throne of Christ, and this is the confidence, that all men will know the truth, and will know all that is promised, and be aware, and know of a certainty, the truth of the throne of the highest, and the promise of the recreation, prior to the last day. This is not our age, not what we are called to. We exist before this. Unless we are with Christ, at his coming, then, Christ shall remove his spirit from the world, that man have the choice, the last choice, before the end, the final temptation of anything that can be moved from Christ, and at last, the final judgment, and the end of all created existence, forever. The glory of God, fully vested in the person of Christ, will remake all integers of existence, in the righteousness of God, and in him only, shall life survive. Of the angel, of man, of all that belong to the faith, of his righteous spirit, what they shall be, we do not know. What shall become of the damned, we do not know. But there is only the righteousness of Jesus Christ. All else is neither flesh, nor important. It shall never have the audience of God, never know his joy. And in whatever state it shall exists, it shall do so forever removed from life eternal of holy accord. This we preach, the righteousness of Christ, the ark of God, and like the days of Noah, who hath believed our report? The world laughs at the patience of God, like they did before the flood, but no one will escape the eternal kingdom. There will be no more man, no more ages of man, no more times and seasons, no more flesh, only righteousness, only Christ, only His. The kingdom of God is the absolute end of all hope, all faith, all belief, all trust, because it is the eternal truth, alive in all truth's children. It is the eternal family of God. In that family, all is living and known. Nothing is assumed, guessed, or taken for granted. It is, because the Word of God has declared it, all live in inescapable righteousness, inside the Spirit of the Eternal, inside His love, inside His truth, inside His heart, forever. And in Him there is no iniquity, ever. God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all. Where our faith fails, it is faith that is failed, because our faith is not a substance that each one of us has. It is rather the promise that is sworn by God, that we each and everyone believe upon, and that promise is the common faith, the raised ceiling that towers over us all, that none can reach or manipulate. It is ever over us all, every single generation, every child, man, and woman. We are powerless to affect it. It does not move. It does not change. It remains holy, sacred, and true, as first it was spoken, before there was a star or a system, as first it stood, before there was conscious entity or a spirit, as ever it has been, while all things were yet awaiting their day. We fail faith, because we ignore the promise of God. We reject it. We marvel for this world. We taint child and home. We corrupt reason and being. We strangely affect everything with incurable madness of error. Our sins and sinful hearts dare to think they can persuade the holiness of God to become the ways of man. We fail, because the faith will not change, but we will not cease to sway with the winds of every perverse spirit that lures us. Absolute, Christ is King, and His kingdom is guaranteed. His eternity is absolute. Nothing mortal shall remain, not a child, not a mother, not a father, not a nation, nothing at all will survive the instated glory of the righteous one of God, in full effect, the eternal light of God, that has never been seen by a mortal creature, or even angel, shall decimate the finest details of the workmanship of creation, recreating all things in the mouth of the righteous God, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the sovereign equation of all that shall replace existence. His body, His soul, His eternal spirit, when Jesus Christ returns with all His to the highest, then shall be that saying, God shall be in all things, and all things shall be in God, and never again shall anything be less than the righteousness of Jesus Christ. The devil is wroth, because he knows his time is short. Satan versus the Word of God. Satan is the angel of the world, the prince of the world, the ruler of the world, the conscious entity, to whom all the conscious affinity of mind and heart on earth is consecrated. Man so very often prays his heart and his soul to Satan, by mere mention of his temporal desire and want. Satan is the god of the planet Earth, and with him, as beneath him, are countless invisible and visible forces. Few would ever suspect they were not of God, few would ever sense or see the difference, and each one could end nations. Just as the angels of God have time and again, Satan and his angels resist the light of God. They fight the angels of God, and have done so for as long as mortal flesh has memory, and such is written in their memory, told 100 ways, 1,000 times. They have power to resist, power to win battles, power to claim victories, but never, if against the Word of God Himself, can a single angel of any side have the victory. And any angel carrying the Word of God into battle is as equally indispensable as the Christ of God himself. They've murdered millions of unborn children. They've slaughtered innocent souls like they were worthless parasites. They've killed light after light that came forth to call the people back to God and Christ. But they couldn't scratch the herald, or the light of God, Moses, nor Jesus. They tried to kill Moses before he was born. They tried to kill Jesus before he was born. They tried. They failed. They could not, because the word of God was upon them, sealed them, protected them, kept them, bound them to the eternal Spirit of God. Imagination is not an acceptable alternative to the live presence of the eternal Christ. Within the walls of creation, everything is fair game. Victories, battles, wars, all writhe like two snakes wrapped in endless combat. Force fights force. Rule, battles rule. Powers challenge power. This is the nature of the one versus the nature of the other. The dominant conclusions of every second portrayed across time, until defeated and replaced by another. Powers, rulers, spirits, they contest each other here, at every turn and second. They make their claim. They brave and dare the other like mighty men of war, to set straight who has the right to rule. And this, for the temporary season of their prestige. It befell creation, that Lucifer was set above the works of all things, a Christ-like figurehead, set, for the temporary residency of his office, an office, he somehow imagined was his forever, that he would become Christ, and never be replaced, that he would sit upon the throne he merely represented, and become the incarnate form of God in this and every reality under the highest. Satan, in all carnation and form, is that spirit that can never sit upon the throne of Christ, that can never be holy, that can never be righteous, that can never be eternal, that can never be God incarnate. But in foolishness, pride, and unbearable jealousies, it imagines itself to be all these things. He is the deceiver of all the world, the ancient dragon, because he believes he is God, he believes he is holy, he believes he is divine. He has forsaken the truth of Christ, and in spiritual madness, he fights the Holy One of God, and takes every fool with him. Satan sits upon an imagined throne, a throne of illusion, that owns the world in its grip. The mystery of the Word of God is that the Word of God is God. No one can have the victory over the Word of God. Jesus chose to lay down his life, and the Word of God, that can never die, was risen above every law of death and creation, in absolute victory over veil and rule and being. When Jesus Christ was born in the flesh, he entered into enemy territory, not simply creation, but earth itself, home of the serpent, and not a single angel could stop him, not a single angel could fight him, not a single power could resist him. We are in enemy territory, we are born here, born in the domain of Satan, captives, on so many levels, according to so many veils and rules of majesty. But Christ, our sovereign God, is the one to whom we go when we die. We are not prisoners of death, but bound servants of the eternal Spirit of life. The Word of God is the prince over our people, not Satan, and our prince, who is the everlasting king, with the eternal kingdom, and the eternal rule, will take everything from Satan. He will strip him spirit and power, and leave him, lone and crumbled. He is sent by God, to take the kingdom from the devil, to remove the earth from her place, and to judge the souls of hell according to his Father's gospel. Fear him. There is not an angel anywhere that does not fear Jesus Christ. He is the only absolute value, in any place, outside the invisible reality of the highest himself. He is God, where no mortal, and no angel can be. He is absolute, absolute in power, absolute in truth, absolute in all things. He is God, upon all the stretches of creation, God, upon all the reaches of the heavens, God, upon every rule and integer of time and space. He is God, absolute, in all realms, values, and realities. Stars tremble, planets cry, souls panic in their relentless exposure, rulers beg, demons, like rodents, quiver. But the fool does not fear Jesus Christ. Everything else quakes at his mention. The most powerful angel in existence is going to get his spiritual being whooped, and to explain that, see this, Christ is not from existence, Remove Christ from the equation of your thinking, and the most powerful being in existence is the angel Lucifer, who is the transcendent spirit of iniquity. Without Christ, the most powerful forms of conscious authority inside existence are the unholy trinity of iniquity, Satan, and Lucifer. They are different, but they are the same. Not a single dark entity is higher. Not a child, not a man, not a woman, not a foreign figure of any kind. Nothing that is inside creation is stronger, wiser, more powerful. Jesus Christ is going to end this creature, because nothing is higher in power, authority, or presence than He. You could multiply the enemies of Christ by infinity, and they could not touch Him. A billion times infinity would not yield not a creature so powerful that it could even lift the eyelid to look toward the righteous throne of Jesus Christ, unless He Himself commanded that entity to give its attention to Him. The fool trembles at Satan. The sincere soul fears the Son of God. Nothing in creation can equal the wisdom of fearing Jesus Christ, because He is exception to everything we think we know, beyond all the laws of reality, and sent forth from within the Spirit of the Highest, the Spirit of people, and the Spirit of the Church. Mortal man is equipped from his start with a sense of spiritual truth, and like water and air and all the elements around him, he senses a fluid and flexible and attractive spiritual call. A deeply inset sensation transacts with reality when he interprets spiritual force. He tingles. His hairs raise. His skin prickles. His mind hyperextends like melted ice or goo, dangling unconsciously toward aimless pathetic mess. Man laughs off the notion of spiritual reality, until he cannot deny it, until he's encountered some frightening and unexplainable force, or felt things he'll never be able to put into words. He laughs, and then he laughs no more. Man cannot perceive spiritual force, because man is spiritual force. Man is the toddler of powers, the delinquent of conscious forces. He is the infantile mess of something he cannot begin to imagine. Man is born in the flesh. He becomes a spirit, not in the moments after death, in the life he lives. And spiritual forces are eager to gather his conscious being to their shared interests. Sex is a spirit. Hate is a spirit. War is a spirit. Peace and love are spirits. It is beyond man to understand this, because he sees will, but cannot see value. And it is that value is a spirit, and several values share a common host, as any man is, as any demon-possessed man or child or woman is, as any entity committed to God is. We become a spiritual force. This is called a family, and several families become a community, and several communities become a church, and a church is spiritually governed collective of all the values within its host body, and that host body, church or world, is the very same being that forms the concentrated whole. In the spirit of conscious identity, people are a spiritual force, a communal power that can lay nations to waste, eliminate hunger, destroy gangs, end corruption, resist evil, require responsibility and earnestness from each other. People become the spirit of their generation. They become the voice and the power that wields every infused answer of tolerance and security. They say yes. They say no. They blind themselves. They let their entire generation be coerced into a constant state of lethargy and ignorance. People are the spiritual force of their own collective standard. Whether that standard ignores criminals and child abuse and poverty, or takes on the mutual welfare of each other, people are the spirit of their own government. They allow every integer of legally recognized authority to pass through the gates of the day and carry over into tomorrow. They allow men and women to lie. They allow them to secure power. They allow them to manipulate the information they receive and the education their children are brainwashed by. The church, by principle, is the same kind of power, the power to allow satanic influences to corrupt the bride of Christ, the power to let go of all God-inspired, godly-framed constitution of commitments to righteous lifestyles, and the power to set their children up for spiritual failure by allowing ungodly circulation of anything that challenges Christ. Satan versus the Spirit of Christ. Every craftiness imaginable is preset against the citizen of our faith, to pull us, to call us, to tempt us, to entice heart and heartstrings for thirst and want, to coat the eyes of our flesh with mesmer and haze, to rebuke our sane conscience into childlike coward and insecurity of sureness. It is unknown to most that the spirit of Antichrist works against them, their own faith, and the holy mutual faith of all the church, daily and viciously. Satanic influence, through the media of the world, the consecrated speech of the servants of the world, its celebrities, its infused youth, its sympathetic and Dulnover supporters, entangles the conscious faithfulness of the saint, calling it to its own judgments, which are set already to return to the judgments of the world. Because the flesh is natural citizen to the world, our faith, if it is the faith, has nothing that it gains or loses from us. It stands forever over us, confident in the promise of God, who is the sole power to both proclaim it and to fulfill it. Our faith, if it is the faith, has nothing to do with what we think, how we feel, what we want in world or life. It has a single interest, the eternal word of God. We are clay, molded and modeled after fancy that lures our heart and our will. There is nothing stable or certain about a man or a woman or a child, except the predictability of their fall from the faith, because every single one of us, no matter how sure we are, will have at least one moment in this life where we followed our own heart, or chased our own will, or sought the sparkle in our eye. We've all held the opinion and esteem that had no place in the court of God's wisdom. All felt the lullaby of earthly romances and physical yearnings. All stung and pained and hurt and pinched with temptations that we couldn't escape, or felt like there would be no tomorrow if we didn't cave into these chest-tightening insanities. The faith rests on Jesus Christ. Nothing a man can say will change this. Nothing an angel can do can change this. No amount of discoveries, or ancient literature, or past technologies relived, will undo the sure promise of God. And strong delusion is determined already by God's promise. Man is destined to seek the riddles of the heavens, to sway with the hiss of the serpent that promises them such revelations of knowledge and heredity. But there is nothing under the sun, nothing in the cosmos, nothing smart and able beneath the feet of man, that can ever overwhelm, unmake, or put to rest the sovereign promise of God, who is Jesus Christ. The promise of God is Christ, and all things sealed in Christ, all truth, all knowledge, all eventuality, all, in and from within, Jesus Christ. The promise of God is the unseen eternal everything that waits patiently to be revealed from the mystery of Christ, the eternal kingdom, the eternal ever, the eternal age, that never shall end. They are the promise of God, and they are right around the corner, moments away, hours, in heaven's eyes, minutes, in the moment. It is destined, sworn by God, promised, and set upon the chronology of the will of God. It will not be deterred. It is the most sure event in all of history, and we are invited to this day, Christ's, the end.